Bolic, all the way from Canada, but originally from Belgrade.
Yes.
So, Miodrag Bolic.
Thank you. So, I'm an associate professor at the University of Ottawa, Canada, and I'm doing research in RFID, Internet of Things, and biomedical engineering. So, this talk is kind of a merge between these two, between IoT and biomedical engineering technology. So, I would like to encourage you to interrupt me at any moment, ask questions, tell me what you think, if you have any opinion or comments. So, let's make this presentation a little bit interactive. Okay, so what I would like to talk to you today is about wearable devices, about devices that people carry to measure their physical conditions, about some challenges and research directions in the field. So I'll be talking about types of sensors and actuators, about quality of data, form factor, and so on. And then about some research that I'm doing and some companies that I'm starting or started, that I have started over there. So I will be talking about all of that and a little bit about future directions. Okay, so why is such a big interest for using Internet of Things in healthcare? So there is an increased number of people who need help, and these people need help either at home or in the hospital. And these are some of the reasons why people need that. So obesity is growing, people are getting more and more obese. They have relatively poor diet. Then population is aging. The number of people, let's say older than 65, is growing and keep growing. So we need to help these elderly people at home as well as in the hospital. So we need technologies to support this increased number of elderly people. There is a large amount of spending on chronic diseases. So these diseases are like diabetes, high blood pressure, and so on. So we need to find a way to monitor these. And then this actually means a huge market opening for many companies, for new research that will support all these technologies. And Internet of Things is one of the great candidates to kind of jump in and provide solutions for all these problems. Okay, so let me just talk about some applications, and I will also give you some examples that I'm working on, and then later on we'll be talking a little bit more about that. So the first one is monitoring elderly people. So why do we need to monitor elderly people? So they for example, fall down. So when they fall down, many of them cannot stand up. Some of them faint. They are not aware. So some companies came up with a solution that is a kind of a watch where they can press, let's say, the button if they are in danger. So this works if they are conscious, if they are aware. If they are not, then there should be some other way to do it. So how I do it in my lab is we are using radars. We put radars in the room and we monitor what people do. And when they fall down, we try to detect that they fell down. So this is an interesting approach. There are other approaches using camera, but camera can affect privacy. So there are many different ways of how we can monitor elderly, so not only for falls, but also for chronic disease, any kind of chronic disease that they might have. The other application is monitoring patient behavior. So some people need to be monitored. Let's say people who have some neurological problems. You might want to monitor them at home what they're doing. Again, elderly people might worry. Stress monitoring is a big new area of research. We would like to assess stress of people in working environment as well as in like kind of normal environment and kind of do something with it. And it's not easy to detect stress. So, for example, one way to detect stress is to take saliva of people. But this is intrusive, you cannot do it very often. So it will be much better if you can monitor stress somehow using cameras or using some other way. The next application is preventive healthcare. We would like to monitor people and to be connected to the network to tell doctors what is going on using wearable sensors or using sensors that are not wearable, sensors that are attached in the room. The next one is using Internet of Things to monitor different therapies. So let's say people are taking pills. How would the doctor know that they're really taking them? So good solution for that is RFID, radio frequency identification. I'm talking a little bit about that. So number of products out there where people are using RFID to monitor if people are taking pills or not. The last one is using healthcare monitoring to improve drug discovery and development. Companies are spending billions and billions of dollars to develop new drugs. And then they go to trials, and during these trials they have to see if these drugs work or not. If people are not taking drugs during these trials, this is very expensive, they cannot afford that. So again, they are very interesting in monitoring if they are compliant, if they are taking drugs, as well as monitoring of their health conditions. So all of these are some applications, and let me just give some other applications. These are applications for improving processes. So these are people would like to improve processes in hospital. And I will give you one example that I worked on. So the idea was to track blood samples from the surgery room to from actually the place where they are taking blood from one person and then to a surgery room where they are giving blood to another person. And there was a lady in a hospital who was writing down all these blood samples. She was hearing all, she was taking care of all the records and then bringing this bucket with blood samples to the room. She missed one in 1 year. This doesn't sound much, but it was a big problem. There was a suit against the hospital, and therefore the solution was to use RFID, for example, to track blood samples. Okay, any idea why there is a difficulty of using RFID to track blood samples?
Attach them?
It's difficult to attach them.
Powering,
so they do not have batteries, so I was using passive tags.
Privacy. Privacy.
Privacy.
Sometimes it's a problem.
Well, here we are kind of reading these RFID tags using RFID readers and then sending to the cloud, and over there they're kind of protected.
Yeah, but people who don't really understand finally the aim.
Yes,
say,
privacy is a big
tracking
RFID.
I don't know what will be the impact of the magnetic field when you read out the RFID on the blood.
Yeah, or on the body.
Okay.
There is so much magnetic field, you know, in the hospital that I don't think it makes difference.
So there are different RFID technologies, and some of them, the ones that are very commonly used, do not work well near water. And blood is mainly water. They do not even work well near the human body because it's full of water. Yeah. So this was a big problem, how to make it work near blood samples. So then there are some special technologies that can be used. And these are mainly the ones that are used with near field. So near field, magnetic communication, very short range. It can work with blood, with water. Far field, where you want to get like long range, it doesn't really work well. So we had to kind of work with a very short range and put antennas into the bucket, read these tags that we attached on the blood samples, and then somehow locate that lady that was going to the hospital. Okay, so this was one. Another one is finding people and finding equipment. There is an expensive equipment in the hospital, we would like to find it, and we would like to know where people are. And not only patients, but also nurses, and you can imagine that nurses were complaining about that. They didn't want to be tracked all the time. Mm-hmm. So this technology is not really getting so well accepted in the hospitals. And then preventing medical errors. This is a big one. So not to give wrong medicine to a person. So with the IoT, with RFID, with different wireless technologies, we can do that. We can improve the precision, improve processes, and prevent errors. And then there are also some other applications here that are listed. Okay, so let me now talk a little bit about different types of sensors that are used in Internet of Things. So here on this graph, we can see a person, and this person is walking, and there are a number of sensors on it, on him or her. And then these sensors are connected to a phone, smartphone that uses a hub, and it communicates with the cloud. So all of these sensors are wireless sensors, and all of these are measuring different things. So for example, we have an accelerometer here that is measuring how fast the person is moving, and then we have pulse oximeter. What is pulse oximeter?
It's
oxygen in the blood.
Yeah. Oxygen in the blood. So it can get oxygen in the blood, it can also get the heart rate because it is getting pulses. there are some other sensors here, so all of them are connected. So these sensors are called variable sensors. So the major problem with them is you don't want to have too many of them because people will forget to put them. And the power. So you need to recharge them, and then you lose battery and so on. So what they are used for are vital signs monitoring, falls, wandering prevention. Wandering prevention is a big problem in nursing homes in North America, I believe in Europe as well. So people with Alzheimer's disease, they just wander, and you cannot find them. So you put sensors on them. These sensors are wireless, they communicate with some stations, and then you can know where the people are. And then also, with these sensors, there's some intelligent on the cloud side, on the computer side, and then we can provide alarms, notifications, graphs, and so on. So in future, we would like to do much more. We would like to have content-aware measurement. We would like to be able to detect daily activities, to detect social interactions. So this is what I would like to talk today. How we can detect daily activities of people, social interactions, how we can do some more intelligent measurements with sensors that are used in Internet of Things. And also, we would like to assist. It is not that we want to measure, but we would like to stimulate. We would like to give drugs when people are, let's say, when it's time to give drugs. So some people will keep forgetting to take the drugs. So let's use drug patches and then give them drug every night at 8 o'clock. So these are kind of new technologies that are coming, and they're all connected to wireless, to Internet of Things, and they're used in healthcare. Yes.
We had an interesting discussion earlier today about exactly this kind of sending data to the cloud.
Okay.
I mean, talking about security, people don't want other people to know about their data value, and you're speaking about processing on the cloud. And what's the factors that we cannot do it on a wearable object, like process everything in the wearable object, and just like when we have an alarm, send it to the cloud? Isn't this a better solution, or we have limitations still now to process the information before sending it? Because you see, we also saw like two or three days ago a small movie of a president who had a connected heart, and a hacker got into it and stopped his heart.
Yes.
People don't want this to happen. Can it be like just a closed environment which is just only sending data?
Yes, definitely. So so as the processing capacity of these smart devices are increasing, we can do more and more processing on the device. Or locally at home, you can do it on your local PC. But eventually, you would like to share at least some of this data with a medical profession. So, you might not want to send raw data, but you might want to send alarms and notifications. So there are different strategies.
It can be, for example, proximity, like you speak about near field communication.
Yes.
Like if you want to share the information stored, you have to be really near and pass by your device so you can share the data. Is this taking into account?
Yes.
The personal information to transit.
But I'm not sure that people are still using near field communication to send the data, to initiate actually sending the data.
And who is owner of data?
That's
also mentioned cloud, but cloud is fictional terms.
Yes.
What is it, hospital or some healthcare organization? And what if patients need to move their data from one organization to another organization?
So I kind of live in Canada, United States, and I never was able to see my data. So I'm definitely not the owner. So patient would not be able to send data from one, let's say, insurance company to another, but it should be done through these organizations. So if there is a company installing the system in a home, then I guess that company would own the data.
Those questions raise a lot of problematics, because as we're speaking about healthcare, it's a very sensible subject. like for insurance policies, and if they can get the information about someone, if people who are owning the data can sell those information to insurance policy, they can like refuse or make it more expensive, so for someone to get help, this can turn back on us.
That's a huge issue, definitely.
Yeah.
Even for example, when you do biomedical research, there is such a rigorous protocol on how to prevent data to be exposed, let's say, from each subject, and not to mention the personal data that can reveal that you are sick or something, and then you can be fired by a company or something. This is a big issue for them.
And I hope to see in the future some work.
Yeah. Okay. Let me now talk a little bit about infrastructure sensors. These are the sensors that you put in the environment and you monitor the people. So you can have many of these sensors connected in the environment. So multiple cameras. There was a paper from 2015 in which people are using phone, and in this phone there is a microphone and there is a speaker. So they are sending data at 18 kilohertz, which is used as a sonar, and monitor respiration activities. And then they get the respiration activities, and from there they can know if people are having sleep apnea. So for example, they can use, let's say, smartphones to detect breathing, and then to get if they're having sleep apnea. So here I have property exit sensor, camera, pressure mat. There are a lot of companies that are providing different types of mats with pressure sensors. So when you sleep, you put a pressure mat below your mattress. When you stand up, you first step on a mattress, and then they can kind of measure your gait, how well you are kind of moving, and this is very important for people who are doing rehabilitation, and so on. So this one is, as I said, bed occupancy sensor. So people are kind of, this pressure mat is having, let's say, hundreds of, and as people are moving, they can see a quality of sleep. This is also a big deal nowadays. Okay, so what are the applications? Monitoring of health signs, human-environment interactions. We would like to know what people are doing. So let's say if they are touching things, if they are active, and so on. So monitoring falls and human physical activity. Monitoring human physical activity is a big thing nowadays, as you know, with these new smart watches that can monitor different things. Actuators. So some of these devices are not just sensors, they can do some action. So for example, for people who are injured, they can move their, for example, arms and legs. For some, they can do fall prevention due to balance loss. I was in a conference, large biomedical conference, last meeting in Milano, and I was watching a demo of very interesting product. So there is a person who had a stroke, and he cannot move his arm, his legs. So they built a kind of a robot that can move legs, and it has support here so that the person doesn't fall down. So this person stand up from his wheelchair after I don't know how many years and start walking after several days of exercise. So this is a kind of an actuator that can move the legs. So this is a bionic field, a whole new research area. And then treatment, neurostimulation for pain management, for example. You can have different devices that are providing electrical current, and they can be activated or not activated based on monitoring of some activities of people. Let me just give you one example. There is a device that we are developing. It's, you put two electrodes here, and you stimulate the brain for, let's say, 20 minutes, 2 milliamps. And for example, if you want, this can be used for stroke patients. And for example, we are targeting this muscle. And then after, let's say, 20 minutes, we measure the potential of this muscle and it's 3 times more. So for people who have stroke, who cannot move their arms, a bunch of sensors that are connected, plus the stimulators, this is a great kind of Internet of Things application. Okay, so these are types of sensors and actuators that are used in healthcare. So let me just talk a little bit more about these. So these are some different form factors. This one is a smartphone with two electrodes. So with these two electrodes, you touch them with different fingers from different arms, and you measure ECG. So in order to measure cardiac signal, you need to have a kind of circle through the heart. So on this iPhone or smartphone, there are two electrodes, so we can use it to measure ECG. So this is a very simple and nice application of new connected devices for sensing. This is a smart shirt. Again, a shirt with a bunch of sensors that are connected. They are wireless. They can be used to, they're used to monitor ECG. This is a whole new area. Let's build smart jewelry. Let's build a ring that can measure some activity. So this ring has inside photodiode and photosensor and Bluetooth connection, and it can measure heart signal and get the heart rate.
What about energy consumption? Normally this device must consume a lot of energy. Where can you put battery?
Yeah, this is a big issue. So so for now on, I didn't find on the internet how much this device can last. I have some other slides that are addressing. This is a very rough prototype of our device that we are building. This is a and then commercializing. This is a cuff in which we have dry electrodes for measuring ECG. And we are trying to measure ECG only on one arm. This is a kind of new thing. So we would like to have a smart device that we wear here, and then to kind of have, it doesn't need to be blood pressure cuff, it can be any kind of cuff, and then to measure ECG and to get a heart rate. So why here? Because it's, because it's close to the heart, so we can get the signal even though it's from one arm, and then we can detect different arrhythmias. Okay, so we have, as you know, R bands. There is a whole new trend of using headphones for measuring health data. You know that you can measure temperature using device that goes into ear. Now people are developing devices that while you're listening music, you can measure your heart rate. Again, using photodiode and photosensor. This device is connected to the smartphone. It goes to cloud or internet of things or whatever. Hearing aids are also getting intelligent. They can measure different things, not just improve hearing. Let me just tell you about one interesting application also that one company is developing in Ottawa. It's called dental appliances. This dental appliance is having sensor inside. You put it kind of during sleep. And it's not to correct your teeth. It's used to check quality of sleep of people who are driving trucks. And if they do not have good quality of sleep, then they cannot drive trucks. So they want to make really small wireless device that goes into dental application. Has to be charged remotely and has to communicate. Of course, remotely because it's embedded in the dental device. Any suggestions about some other devices? No. Goodbye.
I'm going to be wrong about it.
Yes. Well, you know, all of you know Google Glass. Okay. Let me tell you about one interesting application of Internet of Things that I worked on using RFID. It's activity detection and detection of interactions. So what we would like to do is, we would like to know if people are taking some particular devices or things, and then to know if they keep doing that from day to day, so that we can know that the kind of conditions are kind of stable. Let's say elderly people at home, if they keep being active, that's good. If they are not, then something is wrong. So we would like to detect interaction between people and objects, as well as between people and people. So these are social interactions. So for that we can use RFID, or we can use some low power Bluetooth technologies. So I was involved mainly in radio frequency identification technology. So the idea is to have like RFID tag, passive RFID tag on the arm, and then RFID reader somewhere in the room. And then also RFID tags on the other objects. Now, what is the problem with that? RFID technology doesn't lock it. You just know that the tag is somewhere around, but you don't know where it is. So how do you know that this object is close to my arm? So we cannot do that. So let me just give you some small introduction. So these are kind of tags that we use. These are passive tags. So just antenna, and the tag is just like a piece of, like chip is like a piece of sand, like a grain of sand, that big. So this is one tag, this is another tag, and this is a kind of a reader that we use. And the range, this doesn't have any battery, and the range is about 10 meters. So we can cover the whole room with that. So, as I said, we were using passive tags at 900 megahertz. This is the only frequency range where we can achieve that long range. Okay, let me just give you some ranges. I don't know if you know that. Different ranges are used for different things. So, for example, if you use, show my huge phone. So, if you use, let's say, near field communication, so the antenna is here, it's about centimeter. The frequency is 13.56 megahertz. And the same is used for smart cards. So if you have a card that doesn't have only this kind of chip, but also has antenna around it, this one will also work at that particular frequency, 13.56 megahertz. It is very well protected, so now the question is about encryption. So inside that smart card, there is a chip that is kind of doing encryption and all other things. Similar things are done with the NFC. So this is the frequency range that is used for smart cards, for parcels, for retail application libraries, and so on. This one is the one that Walmart was pushing for kind of tracking items in stores and in stocks. So this is long-range passive RFID. So this is the one that I use to track people. Mm-hmm. This is active, 2.45 gigahertz, active RFID. Active RFID means like this kind of phone without anything else but wireless communication, just sending unique ID every day, say 1 minute. So this will be an active RFID tag. This one is used in hospitals, for example, for tracking elderly people, for detecting faults. So the batteries can last between, let's say, 15 days and 1 year on these active RFID things. This technology is kind of older technology used mainly to track animals. So what we used for tracking people is this passive UHF RFID. And then we kind of developed a system where one tag can detect another tag, and then detect activities and detect social interactions among them. Okay, so social interactions are very important for Internet of Things and knowing activities of people, because you would like to know what is the interaction between a person and things, and also between things among themselves. Okay, let me just give you an interesting application that you already mentioned. This is remote monitoring of people. So one of these applications is, one of these sensors is radar. And if this radar is, let's say, this big, and you put it on the ceiling, and it can detect whatever movement there is. So what do you think? Can it detect heartbeat?
No, not enough for energy.
In majority of the cases, not. But heart is also moving, even though it is moving only about several millimeters. And if you are working, let's say, at 26 gigahertz, it can detect even heart.
Even if somebody is wearing some clothes?
Even through the clothes.
Mechanically?
Yes, it is detecting mechanical movement. So we just go through the clothes, through your body, and detecting movement. Now, if you are moving, if you are walking, it cannot do.
So by radio?
By radio communication, yes. So what we are having is a network, wireless network of radar, of a monitor health status. Some kind of data has to be provided to the family doctor through some wireless network, So this is the patient as well, sorry, with sensors and actuators. So some of this data has to go through family doctor, some of this data has to go to the son or daughter or family member. Some data might go to the health manager. So doctors over there are very busy. They don't want to look at so much data. So some of this data has to be processed before going to the doctor. So this is why we have this health manager that can kind of alarm doctor if needed. And then some of this data is stored to the server and aggregated. So this is a kind of a big system. So let me just talk about one more thing that is very important, and this is the data quality. If you have all these sensors on people, how do you know that you are collecting good data? And how do you know that you are collecting data from a proper person? So let's say you have monitoring using cameras at home. How do you know that you are monitoring a person who is sick and not his son or daughter? So this is a huge issue, unsupervised data collection. How do we handle that? And then regarding quality, if you get a lot of kind of garbage data from these sensors, from Internet of Things devices, what do you do with it? This is what we have as a big problem with our, let's say, radar for suicide detection. If the person keeps moving too much, we cannot detect the breathing. And then we don't know if But we assume if he's moving, he's alive. But this is kind of causing us a problem because we don't have a good quality of data. So this is a big thing. And then also the content. How can we process data automatically? So for example, when the data implies emergency, how do we know if people just fall down on his bed or her bed, or he really lost his conscience and kind of fell down on his bed? So there is a big problem with automated systems that is called alarm fatigue. So these systems are providing too many alarms, and then people stop responding to the alarms. So we would like to have a system without false alarm, but this is not possible. So there is a big problem on how to develop intelligent healthcare systems with sensors, with biosensors, with IoTs, that has good automatic assessment of data quality, good automated processing, and no false alarms. This is a problem that is not solved yet.
Can you maybe use more sensors? For example, more different type of sensors, not just for falling. Let's say you have a heart rate sensor, heart rate monitor, and falling and respiratory monitor and stuff like that. And then if all the data from all sensors is suggesting that the person is fell and is unconscious, then you can have
yes, definitely. So this is the way to go. So people are using different kind of sensors, and then they're still not getting 100% accuracy, but the accuracy is kind of improved towards 100%. And there are now different research papers. If you combine these three sensors, how close you're coming to 100% accuracy. Okay, so what kind of data recording do we have? And we need to transfer through the network. So we have a measured sample. We have raw data that we measure from different sensors. Then we have to verify these sensors before each use. Now, this is a big problem in healthcare industry. Sensors are not verified. So you use blood pressure sensor for 5 years and nobody's checking. Use ECG and nobody's calibrated, nobody is verifying. This is a huge issue. Verify patient state before the measurement. Majority of these measurements require that the patient is doing something. So let's say if you do blood pressure measurement, and if you read the standard, how it has to be done. The patient has to sit on a chair without doing anything for 5 minutes, and then during measurement, he or she is not supposed to talk or to move. So there should be, it should be ideal if there is a camera in front that will tell this patient, you are not following the rules, wait for 5 minutes, and then start doing measurement, because this is the procedure, it's how it should be done. But when the doctor gets blood pressure data from the home, he or she doesn't know what the person did before the measurement. So this is a kind of a big thing nowadays to use different sensors to verify the patient's state before the patient is being measured, or to do automated measurement when the patient is doing is kind of doing activities suitable for that. So let's say he or she is watching TV, it's a good time to do the blood pressure measurement unless there is a horror movie. So statistical significance. How do we know that data is significant? The data is not an outlier. So again, let me give an example with blood pressure. If you do blood pressure, you can try it home and then you move arm like this while doing measurements, you will get an outlier. You will get like a big blood pressure. How do you know that people don't do that? Again, it should be monitored. And so on. So these are all different things that needs to be done, but they are not done nowadays. In future, Internet of Things for healthcare, these would need to be done. Then I have several slides on what kind of data can be shared, and this is a bit of issue as we mentioned before. So these are just some of the data that would be ideal to be shared, but because of privacy issues, some of them are not shared. So for example, admission, discharge, transfer notes, vital sign information, medication list, and so on. So all of these should be kind of transferred to the network, should be stored somewhere else, and should be easy to approach and to access by somebody else who is coming to this information. Okay, so let's just give you one slide about the research that I'm doing that is just related to biomedical engineering before going to the conclusion. So if you look at this patient here, so what we are doing in my lab is we are trying to monitor activity of that person using RFID technology. We are trying to detect activities and heart rate using different wearable sensors like blood pressure and ECG. We are doing different stimulations. We are doing bioimpedance monitoring of different parts of the body. In this application, we are using it on the head. We are using different stimulations, let's say on the tongue and on the head, for different applications. So one application of this stimulation is reducing pain on inside the body, pain that is not, let's say, on the surface of the body, so that you kind of target some part of the brain which is possible for the pain, and then you kind of to release the pain of that person. So these are kind of different systems. They're all wireless, they're all kind of connected to the network. And we would like to have a feedback system. We would like to monitor activities and then stimulate when needed. So this is a kind of a feedback loop that is doing monitoring and stimulating. So when we do monitoring, we have to provide data through wireless network, through Internet of Things, do some processing, and then actuate it. Okay, so what are future directions? Definitely more miniature sensors with better power consumption, smaller power consumption. Power harvesting, this is where everybody is going, because we either have not to have batteries or to have batteries that are recharged. And then having unique communication protocols that work with one another. Nowadays we have different devices from different manufacturers, let's say Apple and Google. These devices do not kind of easily talk to one another unless they use just Bluetooth or Wi-Fi. So it would be good to have a, like this M2M kind of system for communication. Automated storage, security is a big issue, and then automated analysis of data. We have to provide alarms, we have to provide some notifications to doctors and medical practitioners, and this is what needs to be done as well. Okay, and I just have one more slide that is more on the research side, and it's a kind of a little bit provocative. So where we are going with the research? So we are going towards the, like, everything that we wear is becoming wearable device. So shirt, watch, belt, everything is becoming kind of a wearable device. And there are different research directions and different products in this direction. Everything that we hold or we touch is also becoming a medical device. let's say, steering wheel in the car. If you sit on your car, if you sit on your toilet seat, it is measuring some data. Yes, it is, it is. So if it can measure ECG from two legs. Book, if you are holding your book, again, you can measure the data. Another research direction is, if this is, if this is where we are going, how do we know who is holding this device, who is wearing this device? We have to be able to identify the person. And then we have to achieve significant measurement quality and significant security and confidentiality of the data. And then finally, regarding assisting and stimulation, this is becoming more and more popular. We will have on ourselves more devices that are doing something on us. So we have to have intelligent actuation and stimulation, as well as there is a new research on how to control and when and how we stimulate. Okay, so that was from me. Okay, so any questions?
Just do we have some research on how to know who is holding the book, or what's the research so far? Is it just beginning, or do we have some solution? Because we can assume that if we register our book, we can assume that it's for me.
Yes.
But we cannot be sure that I am the one who is reading it.
So let's say you'd like to provide ECG data while you're holding the book. So there is a new research direction on providing biometric data from each type of biometric sensor, from blood pressure sensor, from ECG sensor.
How do you know that it's me who is holding the book?
We have to have your ECG data already in the database and then to compare against.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise,
it's not going towards like filmed with some chip in. Inside our flesh.
No, this is done in that way, brain out.
Yeah, in the brain, like some RFID. When you go near a book, it identifies us. We're not going towards this.
There is one club for rich people in the States where they embedded RFID in their shoulders.
Yeah.
So the door can open when we approach. So
yeah.
It's very useful.
This is not the direction of research.
No, it's not. But for example, there is one company that is trying to do the following. So you go to the doctor, you measure your blood pressure, and then based on just raw data, your file should open. So it should recognize that's you, and then open the file. And they want to use that for ECG or something else when you go and enter security facilities. So that it's not just like a finger or an eye.
The thing that is the point we want to measure the ECG because we want to know that we are fine. Okay?
Yes.
And if you use ECG to check that it is us, the day we have a failure, it will like recognize someone else.
It is possible. Yes, it doesn't work 100%.
Yeah. Because I was thinking it's possible. We already do that with the music, with Shazam. We recognize which music it is. We can recognize people like this, but The fact that we want to measure and verify that our heart is working good, we will not be able to use that information if it has a fail.
It still will fail, yes. It's not 100%. Yes.
And what role do you see in medical actuators in things? I understand the role of internet use in sensors, because, but for actuators I don't see. But it's very risky, something to control over Internet of Things. I don't see the line between medical equipment and Internet of Things where we're talking about the creators. What is the role of Internet of Things in that? For sensors and robots,
Yes. Sending
data to cloud and so on, but for the creators.
So these actuators are connected to the wireless network. And for now on, they are activated on a push button. But in future, where we would like to go is that you stimulate or provide, let's say, medicine through these smart touches when needed. And this when needed means based on measurement data. So this actuator should be on the same network as all the other sensors. And there should be some kind of smart device that can process the data and tell this actuator.
Smart device, yes, but things that don't see.
It's already used for people with diabetes, yeah. But it's not IoT, but it's, I think it's going this way. It's, people are taking insulin by serving, yeah, and it measures the level of insulin in the blood, and when needed, it injects automatically.
But if you say that there is a problem with accuracy of data, it can be very dangerous.
Yeah, that's in privacy also.
But in privacy. But this is why we are using many different sensors and trying to kind of, you know, conclude which one is kind of failing, which one is providing good data. So you have the same kind of readiness. You're right that this can be done kind of inside the room. You don't even need to go to the internet. But ideally, we would like to be able to kind of control everything remotely.
As you explained before, there are a lot of RFID technology, like frequency, development. You know, what is, in your opinion, the most promising technology for healthcare, or they are complementary?
For RFID?
For RFID.
Yes, they are complementary. So for let's say monitoring pills and taking pills. People are using short range technologies, HF, 13.56 megahertz. For localizing, they're using ultra-wide band or 2.4 gigahertz. For tracking equipment, either architect 2.4 gigahertz or 900 megahertz, UHF or RF. I'm more interested in this passive communication. So, since there is a big problem with energy in IoT, so I believe that passive communication is kind of good. So, passive communication is where you just reflect energy. And sometimes you can do that, but if you can't do that, then this is good to embed this into sensors.